Jesus, and even after Jesus was born, we looked at those. Last week we looked at something that's happening at Pilate's Hall, and we looked at where Jesus was judged, and we took a look specifically at Pilate and all the things that Pilate was going through as he was making decisions about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Well, today we come to our final sermon in this sermon series. Something is happening at Joseph's grave. Each one of these messages leads through a progression. I hope you can see this now, because we're going to talk about the resurrection of Jesus, even though it's not Easter. We're not going to focus specifically on Jesus himself and the resurrection, but there were things that were happening in and around the tomb of Joseph as Joseph lent his tomb to Jesus. And I'm going to say lent his tomb to Jesus because Jesus only needed it for 3 days. Amen? So it was a borrowed tomb. And so this morning, I want to, it's kind of lengthy, but I want you to capture the whole gist of what is happening here. Would you stand with me this morning as I start reading in chapter 19, starting in verse 38. John chapter 19, starting in verse 38. And then we're going to pray and get into God's word as we can pray. Starting in verse 38. Actually, if we look back in verse 30, so when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. And there were some things that took place after the death of Jesus on the cross, where they pierced his side, which was according to Scripture that had already been written. And now we have verse 38. Starting there. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him permission. So he came and he took the body of Jesus. And Nicodemus, who at first came to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds. And then they took the body of Jesus and they bound it in strips of linen with the spices, as the custom of the Jews is to bury. Now in that place where he was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So there they laid Jesus because of the Jews' preparation day, for the tomb was nearby. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. And she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciples whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him." And Peter therefore went out and the other disciples and were going to the tomb. So that they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. And he stooped down and looked in and saw the linen cloths lying there, yet he did not go in. And then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. And he saw the linen cloths lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. And then the other disciples who came to the tomb first went in also and saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the Scriptures that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away again to their own homes. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for the Scriptures that you have given us to understand what is taking place at Joseph's tomb. And Lord, we know that it was a brand new tomb. And it was a tomb that was only needed for 3 days. And there Joseph, being the owner of that tomb, who just hewed out, cut out between the, among the rocks, Lord, this tomb, that he allowed the body of Jesus to be laid. Lord, there are things that are happening here that I believe that God wants us to understand this morning. And so, Lord Jesus, I'm asking that you would open our ears, open our spiritual eyes, and most of all this morning, Lord Jesus, open our hearts. Open our hearts to receive Jesus if we've never trusted him as Savior. Lord, open our hearts to follow him like we've never followed him before.
Amen.
God, ignite a passion in our church for the love of Jesus, to live for Jesus and act like Jesus, so that the world will see that there's something different in our lives. So Lord, use the reading of your word and the preaching of your word to minister to the hearts of those that are gathered here today, your people. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. There are some things that are in Scripture in this last sermon, in this sermon series, that I want to point out to you. You might know it, you might not know it. But there are some things that are taking place that I believe God wants to reveal to us this morning. That I believe if we really sink our spiritual teeth, if you will, into this and hold on to this, it'll change your life. The first thing, if you've got an outline this morning, you've received it in your ministry sheet or your bulletin, I want you to write this down. It comes out of verse 19, chapter 19, verse 38. There are two men, I just want to point out very quickly before I read that verse. There are two men that are mentioned in chapter 19. I believe there's significance in these two men. And in verse 38, these two men are introduced to us in verse 38 and 39. Verse 38, we find that after Jesus' death, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, enters the scene of what is taking place in the death of Jesus. In verse 39, we have someone who was actually introduced to us back in John chapter 3, and his name is Nicodemus. If you remember, there's a very famous verse that all of us know. You've been taught this verse since you were a kid. And it's John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. It's the gospel story in one message. Jesus was speaking that verse. You know who he was speaking it to? Nicodemus. In John chapter 3, when Jesus was quoting this verse to Nicodemus, he was explaining what Nicodemus needed to do to have eternal life. Nicodemus was a little confused about it. He said, Lord, you must be born again. How can a man enter his mother's womb the second time? And Jesus said, no. Jesus in his teachings, it really resonates with me. He uses everyday examples to parallel spiritual truth. And he said, you must be born again. People understand the birth process. And Jesus said, those things that are born of flesh are flesh, but those things that are born of spirit is spirit. Jesus was trying to say, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the one. By me, that's how you are born again, by your spirit. Because living inside of you is death and destruction, sin, a sin nature. And Jesus says, I am the cure for that. I am the one that can give you eternal life. Paul even wrote in Romans 10:13, it says, whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And that whosoever, you can take that word out and you can put your name in and make it that personal. Jesus wants you here this morning to have eternal life if you've never trusted him as Savior and as Lord. Christy and I have traveled. Many of you know I do black chalk art. If you don't, black chalk art, I have an easel that's 4 foot by 5 foot. And I used three different kinds of chalks to draw a picture. And in that picture, while I'm drawing, I'm using something called invisible chalk. It's not really invisible. See, I got a piece here. No, I don't. It's called invisible chalk. And every piece of it is white. Every piece of invisible chalk is white. And there are ultraviolet color pigments in the white chalk. Ultraviolet color pigments are clear. And so that's how it works. So while I'm drawing one picture to the congregation, I'm also using my ultraviolet chalk and my fluorescent chalk to draw a second picture within the picture. So when Christy is singing and the black light comes on, the picture turns into something totally different from what you were looking at. I believe without a shadow of a doubt, Jesus wants to take your life and what it looks like now and through salvation make you totally something different than you were. Scripture says that he wants to take you from death to life. Scripture says he wants to take you out of the darkness of sin and bring you into the light of his glory. How do you do that? The scripture says, for whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. The only way I know to call on the name of the Lord is to pray and to ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins, to come into your heart and be Lord of your life. Jesus was explaining all of this to Nicodemus in John chapter 3. And when we quote John 3:16, Jesus was ministering eternal life to Nicodemus. Oh yeah. By the way, Nicodemus was a pretty high status guy. He was actually because of his status in the community and who he was, Scripture says that he came not only in John chapter 3, but John chapter 19, because we just read it, that Nicodemus came to Jesus by night. Because he was convicted, his heart was heavy, and he had to talk to this man named Jesus. If something was going on with this guy named Jesus, he's changing lives, he's healing people, he's doing things that's never been seen before.
Amen.
And it sounds like some of the things that Scripture said was going to happen when the Messiah was to come. And he went to Jesus by night because he was little afraid. Because you see, Jesus even himself was a little controversial with what was going on. I mean, you go into the temple, and because they had made church a marketplace, Jesus went in and turned the tables over. Jesus was kind of controversial. Jesus didn't mind standing up in the face of the Sadducees and the Pharisees and trying to minister grace and mercy and trying to minister truth to them. He didn't like it. Jesus, even to some, seemed kind of controversial, but it was enough draw that Nicodemus went to him. These two men, I want to examine very quickly. Point number one, God is using, and I'm speaking today in present tense. Even though this happened some 2,000 years ago, what's going on at Joseph's tomb, again, something is happening. That is, in the sermon title, something is happening. Not only was happening then, but I believe that is, stay with me, the is happening even today. And the is Jesus. Amen? If you're with me, say amen.
Amen.
You're not sure, do this. All right, everybody's good. All right. In verse 38, we have a description of a man, Joseph of Arimathea. It says, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, for fear of the Jews, he asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. Jesus had died, they had taken his body down. He had sighed and been pierced. And I got to thinking, I don't know what family member would not have wanted the body of their loved one to bury. So the first thing it says, God is using the most unlikely people. God is using not only then, but he is actively doing it today. I stand before you today as one of the most unlikeliest people to be used by God. about you? If you trusted Jesus and you're saved today, man, you can say the same thing. I know I am. And I got to looking at the things about Joseph of Arimathea. And I got to thinking about these two men who came to Pilate. Where were the disciples? The disciples had traveled with him. I mean, the fight was over. Jesus is dead. Where were the disciples? Where were Jesus' family members? You don't need to answer. Just think about that. Where were his family members? I got to thinking about that when I studied this and seeing that Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, two people that I believe both were saved and were disciples of Jesus. But where were the disciples themselves, the 12, the 11? Where were the family members? They were scattered. There was so much turmoil that led up to the death of Jesus. Everyone was fearful. I can't tell you how fearful I was the day I remember Jesus knocking on my heart's door to say, trust me. There was a certain amount of fear that gripped me to say, well, number one, I got something wrong. I've realized for the first time, God has revealed to me, has opened my spiritual eyes. There's something inside of me that's wrong in my spiritual heart. For death and destruction. By nature, I'm a sinner. And when Jesus revealed that to me, first of all, there was an amount of fear to say, ooh, I've done something wrong, but I've done a whole lot of things wrong once I got to thinking about it. And then I got to thinking about all the people that was in the church. I can't walk up in front of all those people. I can't go to the pastor and tell him I'm a sinner. Well, guess what? Everybody in there knew it was a sinner anyways. But the fear had gripped my heart. And the biggest thing that gripped my heart was the intellect. This Bible. Man, this thing is thick. It doesn't have a whole lot of pictures in it. And at the time, I'm a visual learner. And at the time, I really liked the maps in the Bible. And I would take and even draw the geographically the places where Jesus would travel to. But the rest of this that's black and white and red, you know what gripped me the most? I don't know enough about Jesus. I don't know enough about this book to understand when the pastor asked all those questions, what am I going to tell him? I don't know enough, and fear gripped me so much that on the last night of special services that we call a revival, I stood on the last night with no hope. Because you know why? The service ended. No more invitation. And in my mind, God only moved during the invitation time. I mean, that's when people got up and moved, come forward, come up here, pray at the altar, and come take the pastor by the hand. And when they said the last amen, I was crushed. The fear was crushed. Everything inside of me. And I thought at that point in time, I am going to miss heaven. I'm going to miss everything God has to offer. And my uncle walked up to me at the end of the service. I'm so thankful he did. He said, my nickname back home, I told you before, is Bubby. And he came up to me and said, Bubby, is God talking to you? Man, my whole face was soaking wet. I was crushed. I just received not only the death sentence, but the spiritual death sentence. And I said, yes, God's talking to me. And he said, do you want to ask Jesus into your heart? I said, yeah, but I don't know what's in this book. I don't know enough. What is everybody else going to say? Have you ever felt better? I don't know. Has God ever prompted your heart to go to the altar and pray about something? There is significance to coming to the altar and praying. You can pray in your seat. God does hear you. But sometimes God wants maybe an act of faith or an act of obedience, it's called, to go and kneel at the altar of God and pray. Fear gripped your heart. That's where these two guys were. A lot of turmoil that happened around the death of Jesus. First thing I see about Joseph of Arimathea is that he overcame his fears. Said he was a disciple. He was a secret disciple. But now all of a sudden, Joseph of Arimathea no longer says, I'm going to be a secret disciple. I'm going straight to the top to Pilate. I'm going to ask for his body. He revealed that he was a follower of Jesus. He took audience with Pilate. He must have been a man of status to even be able to get in to see Pilate. So I've done some research real quick. And we're looking at John this morning, but if you look at all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they're synoptic Gospels, which simply means that there's a synopsis of the life. They write a summary of the life of Jesus. Matthew described Joseph of Arimathea as a rich man. Mark described him as a prominent council member. He took courage in going to Pilate, even though he was not only rich, but he was politically connected. He knew Pilate. And he was willing to lay all that aside and stand before Pilate and say, I want his body. We can't just leave him out there. Everybody else is running scared. Everybody else is fearful of their life. I don't mind identifying with him. He stood up and asked Pilate. And Pilate gave him the body of Jesus. And then Joseph of Arimathea gave Jesus his own tomb. Then we have Nicodemus. One of the things I wrote about Nicodemus that I love is Nicodemus came out of the darkness. He came out of the darkness. He's no longer coming to Jesus at nighttime anymore. Jesus is dead. And Nicodemus moves up alongside Joseph of Arimathea. The scripture tells us that Nicodemus back in chapter 3 was a very politically connected man. He was a religious leader. And he had money in it, even in itself. And Nicodemus came out of the darkness at the appointed time to assist Joseph. In other words, Nicodemus knew what was right and he did it. What did it cost him? Nicodemus sacrificed by identifying with Jesus. He sacrificed by giving the myrrh and the aloes toward the burial of Jesus. Scripture says he gave 100 pounds of myrrh and aloes. Scripture says that Joseph brought in fine linen to wrap the body of Jesus. Do you know what those expressions are? Not only of culture back in the day on how they buried people, but it was an expression of love. They gave their best because of their love for Jesus. And he sacrificed thirdly by preparing the body of Jesus. They both took time. Don't you know everyone there knew that Joseph and Nicodemus had taken the body of Jesus? Everybody was watching. You know why? What did Jesus say? 3 days, I'm coming up out of the grave. In 3 days, I'm not staying in. I'm coming out to show you that God the Father is real and that I am the giver of life and death and I am the redeemer of mankind. I'm coming out. Harold Joseph, Nicodemus over here working. They loved Jesus. They heard his messages. They heard what he preached and they're wrapping, embalming, putting spices or smells all over his body. They wrapped him all the way up and they placed him. Joseph said, you put it in my tomb. It's brand new. Nobody's ever been laid there. I'm so glad that Jesus put Joseph and Nicodemus in the scriptures taking care of Jesus' body. Because God is using the most unlikely people, and that, my friends, listen to me this morning, it includes you. You can disqualify yourself all you want to. I don't know enough. I did that. I don't have enough talent. I did that. I'm worried about what people are going to say. I did that. You might have more excuses than I have, but you know what? Jesus wants to use the most unlikeliest people. And out of all the churches in this country, I don't know how much more that could apply to New Beginnings Fellowship Baptist Church. God can take the most unlikeliest people, and what Satan means for evil, he will turn it around and use it for his honor and his glory. But not only is God using the most unlikeliest people, but God is doing exactly, number two, he is doing exactly as he said with Jesus. He's doing exactly as he said. Exactly, and not only is Jesus ministered, but what was written in the Old Testament, all of the things that were predicted about Jesus took place. He is doing, not only back then, but he is doing, he is actively pursuing the lost sinner to be saved. He is actually pursuing and pushing us as disciples of his to follow him like we've never followed him before. I hadn't had a TV since I moved here for the past 3 months. And I was a frequent flyer on the news channels and everything else, trying to keep up. Y'all do too. Y'all watch the news. My brother called me last night. He said, "Hey, have you seen the news?" I said, "No." And I said, "I kind of like it."
Damn, brother, I get that.
And he said, "You won't believe what's in the news. And begin to share with me some of the events." He said, "Does it sound familiar?" He's talking about this. And I said, "Yes, it sounds familiar. Yes, it's getting close. Yes, as some of my pastor friends say, it's glorious to be dark. Yes, I see the signs. Yes, I hear the rustling of angel wings. Yes, I believe it's close. And I want to do everything I can in my Christian walk to be obedient to whatever it is that God is doing in my life." What's God doing in your life? What is God doing in your life? Is God doing anything in your life? Are you just kind of sitting stagnant? Is the circumstance of this world just kind of weighing in and pressing down on you? You're in the right place. Because you see, the same God that was doing something back at Joseph's tomb is the same God that is doing something in the life of this church and in this very service. God wants to do something.
Amen.
What is it this morning? Amen. I don't know. Keep listening. Keep listening. He's very clear. Look at chapter 20, verse 1. I want you to look there with me. Chapter 20, verse 1. "Now, in the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciples whom Jesus loved, and said to them, 'They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him.'" Mary Magdalene, I believe, as God is doing exactly as he said, Mary Magdalene, listen to this. If you're taking notes, write this down. Mary Magdalene's focus did not follow her faith. Mary Magdalene's focus did not follow her faith. So, Brother Wilton, what do you mean by that? Have you ever gotten distracted in your walk with Jesus? Have things happened in your life and you got totally sidetracked? Fall by the wayside. Wind up in sin. That does happen, you know. Happens to me. I'll be the first one to raise my hand. But I'm so thankful that God doesn't leave us there. He comes knocking. Knocking on your heart's door and asking you, pleading with you to come back. Maybe some of you this morning say, "God, and been doing a whole lot in my life. Maybe you need to see if your focus is matching your faith this morning. Because if your focus is not matching your faith, you're going to be doing a lot of good things. It's not what God's doing. It might have good purpose and good meaning, but it's not the direction God's going. I believe, I want to look at three things. It's in your notes. I believe three things. Mary Magdalene, she loved Jesus. I believe she loved Jesus. I mean, it, Scripture says that on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb. She was one of the first ones there. And it says she was there early while it was still dark. I probably lost half of you right there because most of them, some of you are early morning people and some of you are late night people. To say that she got there early in the morning while it was still dark, to me, is an expression of love. I want to go see Him. I want to go to the tomb where Jesus is, the body. I believe she loved Him. I also believe that not only was she there early, but she was there early for a purpose. It was after the Sabbath. She went there first thing. That was the number one thing on her list for that day. I want to be there early. But also we see further along that in verse 2, she ran and came to Simon Peter. When she went to the tomb and seen that the stone had been rolled away and the body of Jesus was gone, she reacted quickly to what was taking place. And in her mind, she went straight to Peter and to the disciple and said, "They have taken the body of Jesus away. They have moved the stone." Who is they? Scripture doesn't tell us who they are, but she was blaming and looking at, her focus was on other people instead of what God was doing. God is doing something at Joseph's tomb. And He has opened the door not to let Jesus out, but He has opened the door to let the disciples in, to let Mary Magdalene in, and to ultimately let us in, that we might have eternal life. I believe that Mary Magdalene's focus did not follow her faith. But also there's a second group of people that was there, the disciples. And it's I've got written in my note that the disciples responded to the move of Jesus, not the miracle. The disciples responded to the move of Jesus, but not the miracle. So what are you talking about? Let me be a little bit more descriptive. The disciples responded to the move of Jesus' body and not the miracle of His resurrection. Their focus did not match their faith. They were sidetracked. And they were more concerned about who got it. Was it noble? Yes. Did they love Jesus? Yes. But their focus was off. God says, "I am doing a new thing now. And His name is Jesus, the resurrected Lord." Don't worry about His body. Stay focused on your faith. You are going to see Him again. Let's take a look at the disciples very quickly. I'm almost done. The disciples came. They came to investigate His disappearance. They got the report from Mary Magdalene. They knew what Jesus had said, but those words that Jesus had spoke, that 3 days later, "I'm going to rise again," it just didn't resonate in their heart. They just didn't get it. And they went to the tomb, and they were very protective, and they were very inquisitive. And Jesus said, "That is my Master, that is the God that I've been following for years, that is the one I'm concerned about. Where's His body?" What a sign of disrespect, they thought. Not knowing that God was doing something for mankind. In verse 6, look at verse 6. Then Simon Peter came, following Him, and went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloths lying there. Peter went into the tomb where Jesus was buried. If you look back up in a few verses for sake of time, I'm not going to read it, but it said the disciples took off running. Mary Magdalene came
to them and told them, hey, Jesus' body's gone. The stone's been rolled away and his body's gone. Somebody stole it. Call Jay Sanders. The body of Jesus is gone. And those disciples took off running. Obviously, Peter was not, or in the scripture, was not, I'm going to say, as good a shape as the rest of the disciples. Because the disciples got there, but I want you to notice what happened with Peter. The disciples ran there and they stopped at the door. There's a lot of people that come right up to church and stop. Stop at their chair, they'll stop at their pew, they'll stop on their aisle. A lot of people, especially when you go on mission trips, where, no matter where it's at, majority of my mission trips have been down in Mexico, and people will stop right at the door, the threshold of the door. They'll stand right there. They won't go any further. They'll stand there and listen. And if too many people are around the door, they'll go around to a window where they can look in and see. But there's boundaries that they place up in their own physical lives to say, I won't go in. Look what Peter did. It said, Peter went into the tomb where Jesus was buried. He took the extra step. He went in to where Jesus was buried. And he investigated. He looked to see what was going on. I want to call something to your attention. In verse 6 and verse 7. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. John actually went into the tomb with Peter. And Peter saw the linen cloths lying there and the handkerchief that had been around the head of Jesus, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. I'll never forget, you don't know the significance of that. I'll never forget one of the last years, I think it was the last year that I was serving here before. For those of you who don't know, I've actually served here before on staff with Brother Larry Jordan, who was a senior pastor at the time. And we had another man on staff. His name was Pastor John Pangle.
Amen.
And Brother John was our outreach pastor. I miss him. I still find myself, after serving here 10 years and coming back, you know, some 5 years later, same hallways, and I still walk down the hall and I want to knock on his door. But he would want to come back if he could. Amen. Brother John loved Jewish Seder's. Meals before Easter time, celebration meals, and a lot of the Jewish customs. And he organized a trip for us here at the church to go to Tyler. And we went to a Jewish temple where the rabbi priest was explaining to everyone, this is what folks ate at the time of the Passover at Easter time. And we ate bitter herbs and different things there that reminded us of all the things that Jesus went through and the sin that he took on as he was crucified on the cross. And then he got to this handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloth, but had folded together in a place by itself. That was a sign. Because you see, when part of the Jewish customs, and even some of us do it maybe unknowingly or knowingly, but part of the Jewish customs, if you had to get up and step away from the table, if you will, for just a moment, and you were going to come back, you would take your napkin and you would fold it, and you would place it there, separate from your plate and everything else. And then you'd go walk away, maybe it's to the restroom, maybe it's to clean your hands, whatever it was. Somebody called you for business. And you place that folded napkin on the table. And when the waiter came around, or the server came around, or whoever else came around, and seen your spot empty, but they seen the folded napkin on the table. You ever been to a buffet before? That folded napkin was there on the table. Because you wanted to leave the sign, you wanted to let the person know who was serving you that you're coming back. If you're finished, and most of the time you wad your napkin up as a paper, you can fold it up and put it in the middle of your plate. That way, when the waiter comes by and they say, can I pick your plate up? Oh, yeah, I see your napkin. light of it. Jesus, I believe, was leaving a sign, and the rabbi shared this with the whole group there, and the whole place almost came unglued. Jesus left that napkin folded in a way, separated in such a way to let not only the disciples, but to let you and I know as a custom within, I am not done. God is still doing things, and I, guess what? I am coming back. It was a sign. There old Peter and John running through the tomb, sitting there looking and investigating everything. There's his linens. Joseph and Nicodemus wrapped him in those things. But did they miss that? Did they see that? There it was, folded as a sign. But then we move farther along into verse 8. Look with me what happened with Peter. Then the other disciples who came to the tomb first went in also. And he saw and believed. Listen to me. If you don't think that your Christian life matters, and that people don't look to you as an example, you don't know what I've done. I don't want anybody being, I don't want to be an example to anybody. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then yes, God desires to use you. God wants to do something in your life, and God wants to use you as a testimony and an example to a lost world. And when Peter took the extra step to go into the tomb and begin to look around and begin to see all the things in that tomb that he'd seen, nobody of Jesus was there. The body was gone. And because of his leadership, Scripture says the rest of the disciples went in. God, I believe this morning, might be asking some of you this morning to take that extra step like Peter did. It's time to stop standing at the threshold of the door, as folks in Tampico, Mexico would do, and then bend an ear to listen, to find out what's going on. It's time for you this morning to stop standing on your tiptoes, trying to see in over the top of all the crowd of people that's there. Jesus says, come in. Jesus said, I love you. Jesus said, you are forgiven. If you just ask, you will receive eternal life. And these disciples followed Peter's example. As believers in Jesus Christ for us today, we need to be an example to a lost world. Some of the things that my brother told me last night that were taking place in the news, folks, we as believers and the one true God and the one Savior, Jesus Christ, we better be ready. Because there is coming a day, I'm telling you, to where we're going to have to say, if we are a Christian, you're going to have to take that extra step. It's no longer I'm going to the church, yeah, I'm part of this church or this denomination or that denomination. It's coming a day, as in the days of Jesus when he was crucified. Are you a part of him? Are you a part of him? Do you believe him? Are you his disciple? Are you his disciple? And we're going to have to stand up and walk the walk if you talk the talk. And Jesus says, I'm doing something. What is he doing in your life? The disciples in verse 10 said that they left the tomb. It says the disciples went away again to their own homes. I don't know if all the disciples were convinced. I don't think they were. There's a Greek word that says they went to their own homes. It's called, the Greek word is proskuneos. It's a word that just simply means that the disciples scattered among their friends and their companions. See, they weren't even from there. So to say that they actually went back to their houses, they didn't even live in Jerusalem. That's not where they were from. And some of these disciples, if not all of them, left out. Once again, with fear in their heart. And when they left out with fear in their heart, they were perplexed. I wrote in my notes here, they went away hovering between faith and unbelief. They were perplexed. They were fearful that they were going to get blamed for the said, 3 days later, I'm going to rise again. They're going to blame us. Let's get out of here. They're going to start pointing fingers at us again. They're already a little shell-shocked from the crucifixion of Jesus. And they scatter among their friends and their companions. The third and final thing I believe that God is doing in Joseph's tomb, God is constantly revealing the message of Jesus. Not only in the folded napkin that was placed there, separate from the linens according to Scripture, but look at verse 12. Third and final point. And Mary Magdalene, she saw two angels in white. She stood outside the tomb weeping. Stooped down and looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. I'm thinking about that. What was that angel at just a few seconds before that? All the disciples had now conjugated into the tomb. Remember, Peter and John ran in and said the rest of them eventually followed in. I believe God can do anything, at any time, at any place He so desires. In my life, in your life, and in the life of this church. All I want to know is, God, where are you at work? And I want to get in on it. That's what Henry Blackaby says in his study, Experiencing God, for the men that are studying that on Monday nights. Find out where God is at work. Get in on it. Mary Magdalene sees two angels at the tomb. The two angels spoke to Mary Magdalene. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord. And I do not know where they have laid him." Now when she had said this, she turned around and saw who? Jesus, standing there. And she was so consumed in her self-grief and her mourning, she did not know that it was Jesus. Mary Magdalene actually encounters the risen Savior. Jesus said to her, "Woman," in verse 15, "why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" And she, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." One thing I can say, Mary was focused. She was so focused that she missed Jesus. If there's one principle I can learn in this, is God help us as a church not to get so focused on anything but Jesus. Am I thankful for what God's doing next door in our sanctuary? And we're having folks meet here, and Miss Kim and Brother Bruce providing breakfast for us in the mornings. I mean, this is fantastic. But I don't want to get focused on remodeling a building and allow that to draw us completely off of Jesus. If nothing else, I want to thank Jesus for what He's doing in the life of our church. But our focus needs to be Him. Amen? I don't want you to get so focused in your personal walk with Jesus that hobbies, that sports, that anything else pulls your focus off of Jesus.
Amen.
And say, I asked a while ago, is God doing anything in your life? Some of you might have gotten a big, I don't know. My question would be, is there anything in your life that's pulled your focus off? Just with sports alone, I remember back in the day when the cities used to meet with the pastors and ask the pastors, "When are your revivals? What's going on in the life of the church?" Because we don't want anything in baseball to conflict with the church. And now, it's totally flopped. And if your son or your daughter goes to a coach, most of them, and ask, hey, look, I've got something going on at church. I've got something happening in my youth group, Brother Kenny. I've got something happening in the children's department. Or even if you're a coach yourself and saying, I've got something going on in my church, we can't practice. Woo! You better hold on. Because somebody, somewhere, I guarantee, is going to raise up and start slashing away at you because you're a Bible thumper, a Jesus follower, and whatever else name you want to put on it. And that's why I say, that's the wrong ones. That's the fringes of you having to stand up and be who God's called you to be. There, Mary Magdalene was. She encountered the risen Savior. The last thing, Mary Magdalene went and told her story. There Jesus was in verse 16 as Mary was pleading for Jesus' body. Jesus said to her in verse 16, Mary! It's an exclamation point there. I don't want to yell it. But as she was talking, he said, Mary!
My mom was a godly woman. I wish y'all got to know her. She loved Jesus. I used to ride my bike around the neighborhood. I grew up in a Leave It to Beaver neighborhood. All the people, all the neighbors knew each other. You couldn't do anything wrong within a 100-mile radius before it got back to Mom and Daddy in the town I grew up in. Parents out in Louisiana, they travel on the bayou fast. And I could be out on my bike anywhere I wanted to be. I could be playing with my friends anytime. And my mom would call, I could hear, Wilton, it's getting dark. I'd look around, come on guys, let's keep going. Let's keep playing. It's not dark yet. I got plenty of time. I know how long it takes me to ride home. Wilton, about 15 minutes later. Don't worry about that, guys. We're good. It's only about the third time, about 30 minutes later, when the sun went down, it was no longer singing, Wilton. It was, Wilton! There was a certain amount of panic in Mama's voice. And I did about 60 on my bike to get home. There was a certain way that Mama and Daddy, when they meant business, when they were trying to get your attention, they would say your name. A lot of you were smiling. And you almost had parents that kind of had the same voice. They knew how to get your attention. Jesus, at this point in time, there's an exclamation point. He is trying to get Mary's attention. And he just says her name, and it's the way he said it. In verse 16, she turns around and says to him, Rabbi, which is to say, teacher. And Jesus said to her, obviously she must have jumped toward him because we've already established that she loved him. And in verse 17, do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and to your Father, my God and your God. Verse 18, Mary Magdalene came out and told the disciples. God is constantly revealing the message of Jesus. How does he do it? For you and I to go tell our story. How is he constantly revealing the message? That you and I tell people how you receive Christ, how you met Jesus, how you ask Christ into your heart. And not only through salvation, but he wants you to tell the story about what's going on in your life. What he is continuing to do. How you're growing. What miracles God might be doing in your life. And on and on and on. God wants you to tell your story. Do you have a story this morning? You might be here this morning and say, Brother Wilton, I don't even know if Jesus lives in my heart. I'm not sure. And Brother Wilton, there's a lot of people here in fear that grip my heart. I don't want to step out. I don't want people to know that I'm a sinner. So let me do this, leading an invitation. I am the chief among sinners. And I am saved by the loving grace of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And he my Lord and Savior. Paul wrote in Romans, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So we're all sinners. So lay that fear aside this morning. Lay the shame aside this morning. Disciple of Jesus that might have lost your focus, come this morning in repentance. Come this morning in salvation. Maybe this morning you're searching for a church home and you say, oh, Wilton, I believe this is where God wants me to be. Whatever it is that God is instructing you to do this morning, I'm just asking you to come this morning. Be obedient to what Jesus is asking you to do. Because he uses the most unlikely of people. He's doing exactly as he said he was going to do. And he is constantly revealing his message. All of these things were taking place at Joseph's tomb. And it is still taking place today in this service.
Amen.
Won't you obey Jesus this morning? Whatever he's telling you to do, step out and come to Jesus. Father in heaven, we thank you for your message today. Your word is sharper than any two-edged sword. God, you saved a sinner like me and many others in this service today. Lord, if there's someone here today that needs to trust Jesus as their Savior, God, I pray this morning would be the day of salvation. God, let them come. Let them step out in faith and step in to the wondrous love of Jesus and eternal life. Father, I pray that today, if there's a disciple of yours, a believer of yours that is struggling in their walk with you, maybe they've gotten off focus. Father, we're going to have men in front of this church that are willing to pray and lock arms with those believers that are struggling, that we can agree under the leading and the guidance of the Spirit of God, that you can restore and refocus us. Lord, whatever decisions need to be made here today, God, we're your people. Help us to obey. We pray all this in